Okay, we start our session after the coffee break, and it is a pleasure for me to introduce the next speaker, Renato Uca, from
Basque Center for Applied Mathematics.
Basque Center for Applied Mathematics, yeah. Bilbao.
Exactly.
He will speak about transport of Gaussian measures with exponential cutoff for Hamiltonian PDEs. Please.
Thank you very much for the introduction. And thank you very much for the speakers, to the organizers, well, also the speakers, for the nice organization. In fact, I'm not used too much to, well, it's a long time I don't come to it. I'm very glad to be here in presence, and I imagine it's been a bit more effort to organize in this situation as well. Well, all of the speakers, all the speakers, thanks very much for this, and the participants. I have 50 minutes, correct?
Yes, around 50.
Okay, so this is joined with Giuseppe Genovese and Nicolai Zetto. And I will essentially try to complement a bit the talk of Nicolai. So I will explain, introduce the concept of invariant Gibbs, Gaussian measures, Gibbs measure, invariant measure, and quasi-invariant measure already. I will explain what you can do for two particular models. One is the Benjamin Bonnemann equation, and one is it's a bit more technical, is the gauge map associated to the derivative in the initial equation. So in the first part, for the Benjamin Bonnemann equation, this is there is one part which is very classic, it's just the Gibbs measure. And this will be just the adaptation of an argument which is very classic and has been is due to Burguet in the context of the nonlinear Schrödinger equation. But it's very easy to explain in a talk, and I think it's an important idea. So I liked the first part of this talk. The second part is a bit more modern, so we consider this concept, which is a bit weaker. It's quasi-invariant measure, still for the Benjamin Bonnemann equation. And then for this map, which is just change of variables, which is important for a nonlinear Schrödinger model, and I would try to motivate, mostly to motivate why I think this problem is interesting. So,
doesn't respond so fast.
Now, okay, there is just one first slide in finite dimension. So we have an Hamiltonian system, which where the variable is a complex vector in dimension n. The Hamiltonian is a real function. Okay, in this formulation, it's easy. Well, if you have this equation, it's easy to see that there is a measure which is conserved, which is the Lebesgue measure. This Lebesgue measure, more precisely, so built using the real and imaginary part of zeta, so in dimension 2n. This is essentially just the Liouville theorem. Maybe this is not the most classic way to introduce the Hamilton equation, but it's useful for this talk. And you may see that if you take the real and imaginary part of Z, they solve the usual Hamiltonian structure. And here, instead of the symplectic matrix, you have multiplication by I. And the important thing is that this guy is skew symmetric. So you have that this object is invariant. And once you have this, you may think about building other invariant measures, which are maybe more interesting. If you have some quantity which is conserved, of course, in the Hamiltonian system, you have the Hamiltonian which is conserved. And so you can build a measure like this, which is particularly interesting, considering exponentiating the Hamiltonian, as long as this guy is finite, as long as the exponential is integrable. Of course, for instance, if the Hamiltonian here is positive, this is finite, but we agree that. But well, in general, there is no, this doesn't have to be the case. It's not so obvious, you can renormalize. And this is even more the case when, well, no, okay. This is always true. And also, In this case, you know that the Hamiltonian is preserved, but maybe there are systems which have more concept quantity, and you can use them, but there is not a particular reason to choose the Hamiltonian. And in fact, later we will not choose them. In our PD, we will not choose the Hamiltonian. So this was just to recall the finite dimensional setting and to recall that this measure is preserved. Nikolai already did. So this is the equation that we studied in the first part of the talk, which is called the Benjamin monomial equation. And here U is real valid, and is we always consider one dimensional setting periodic solutions. And since U has a zero average, well, since the average is preserved by the equation for simplified bit notation, we just look at zero average solution. So we always neglect the zero Fourier mode. And here, this d beta is the fractional derivative of d beta defined by in the Fourier space in this way. So the equation is has been introduced by Benjamin Bonamaoni in the case beta equal to 2 to model water waves of small amplitude as an alternative model to KdV. In fact, in this talk, we are mostly interested to generalize a bit this, so to consider also fractional dispersion. So this beta doesn't have to be two, can be smaller, and we will take it bigger than one. In fact, even very close to one in this talk. And the case beta equal to one is the dispersion in this case. We'll see maybe to be more clear in the next slides. So there is this system is Hamiltonian, we see it, and so if we have some conserved quantity, we may hope to build some invariant measure, and the quantity that we want to use is this, we call it energy, and it's essentially just the beta over two, the H beta over two norm, Sobolev norm of the solution. And why it's conserved is just because if you take the scalar product of the equation in F2 against U and you integrate by parts, you see. And the beta becomes beta alpha and integration by parts. And these terms, they don't give contribution because they are both total derivatives. So this quantity is conserved. And we should say something also about the well-posedness. Okay. To study the well-posedness, it's maybe useful to rewrite the equation in this more natural formulation for people studying PDs. So you see that the nonlinearity is quadratic, and the operator here in front of the nonlinearity is even a smoothing operator for beta bigger than one. But as I said, that we are quite interested in. We should think about beta equal to one plus epsilon in this talk. So at the end we have a bit of smoothing, but essentially. But once we write the equation like this, okay, it's easy to see that this is local well-posed in H sigma for sigma bigger than one half, essentially just because you need to handle the square here and you need a space which is stable under product. Well, you just need the algebra property that here you have for sigma bigger than one half. And so since this is conserved, of course, you are also global well-posed in H sigma for sigma bigger than beta over two, because you use this conservation to control the H1 half norm, and then you implement again local theory in time. Okay, this is of course very easy. Maybe it's not super satisfactory because still here we have a lot of the regularity, and maybe we hope to go down. And the particular of the peculiarity of this equation is that in fact, maybe Sobolev spaces are not really the best setting. And in fact, you can show that this is local posed even in C sigma. This is all the space of W sigma infinity, or any sigma positive. Just because the linear evolution you can also control in all the spaces in this case. So you can use it, in fact. This doesn't happen. The shared equation is clear, it doesn't happen, just because the linear parts. And then in sigma, you have the algebra property. So you can close the, well, okay, this is just the jobs. The thing that is, you have local closeness here, but it's interesting to see that the time of existence of the solution depends on a quantity that you have no hope to control for long times. So this you cannot propagate like the Sobolev. Mm-hmm. And the goal is to show that in fact this you can propagate using the Gibbs measure, not for all the initial data, but for almost all the initial data. This is the important idea that Burgen introduced for NLS. So so I said that so this is the first goal, and we said this is Hamiltonian. Maybe we just write fast the Hamiltonian structure. Of course, to do things rigorously, you should find some finite dimensional approximation, which is an Hamiltonian system, and which is as usual the Galerkin approximation. So you project the nonlinearity on the first capital M Fourier modes, and if you take initial data which are on the same, which are less than capital M Fourier modes active, you stay in some space. So this is finite dimensional evolution. The Fourier coefficient satisfies this equation, which is in the same Hamiltonian formulation that we saw in the first slide. That's why I recall. You may just look at the positive the Fourier coefficient, because then the negative are determined by the fact that it is real. Well, yeah, there are these coefficients, these weights compared to the first slide, but these are not so bad. The important thing is that this guy is the operator here is skew adjoint. Yeah, okay, so you have the Hamiltonian structure, which means that you have the Lebesgue measure in is preserved and is well, is the Lebesgue measure defined using the Fourier variables. So recall again, this is the concept quantity H beta over to norm. And as Nicola explained us, we may hope to build an invariant measure of this form, which is clearly just form. This du doesn't make any sense in infinite dimension. It's not even clear. Well, when you write things in the space variables, it's not even so clear with du. It's a bit more clear, I think, if you write in Fourier variables. So the du is here is this Lebesgue measure built with Fourier coefficient, but here is still infinite dimensional Lebesgue measure, which doesn't make sense. And the nice thing is that, okay, this guy here, we said it's just H beta over two norm, so it factorizes as a product here of infinitely many Gaussian measures. Okay, this is a bit particular. Usually in this thing, as Nicola explained, you have a part which is Gaussian, which is like this, and then you have also weight. In this case, you don't have a correction. In this case, you don't even have it. So this is really a simple model which you can explain. And as he explained to us, this is okay, this doesn't make sense, but you can make sense of this looking at finite dimension, using that this guy factorized, Gaussian factorized, and using the Kolmogorov extension theorem. This is the theorem. So you know this measure makes sense. You cannot do so many analysis using this, or maybe at least it's hard. And so a better way is maybe to think about this Gaussian measure as a measure induced by random Fourier series. So here we just define Gaussian measures like before with the three parameter S. So, okay, so S is not the dispersion of the equation here. This is just for any S, we give this definition that will be useful later, which is similar, well, essentially the same that in the ideas. And this is induced by this random Fourier series. So here you have the coefficients, they are complex Gaussian random variables. They are okay. They have this relationship because U has to be real. And they are independent and normalized because then there is this extra normalization which fits with the covariance of the Gaussians. And the reason for which these are Gaussians is because these are this is the density of Gaussian random variables. But well, Nicola explained really well. I was a bit scared about this slide because to justify this equivalence, but I think he did it very well. So I'm not, I want to do it better than him. So I think I will not say anything anymore about this. Just that, okay, this is with S, which is free parameter. If we want to look at our measure E, we need to choose S equal to B over two. And, because, so we are not object now is real, not formal object. So before we go, I think I also said that okay, it's very random Fourier series because you understand very well the support of the measure, which is if you look at gamma s, it's s minus 1/2 minus sum. So you take s prime small, and it's easy to see that the expectation with respect to gamma s. Yes, the L2 expectation of the here I forgot this should have been yeah, okay, here I forgot the L2 norm inside in the X, right? Anyway, the L2 expectation of the HS prime norm of the random polynomial is finite. This is the computational tissue. And in fact, he said that you can improve more, that you can improve the integrability of this thing. In fact, you can show that the LP expectation is finite with a constant which will depend on P. And this is a factor which depends on the, well, it's a very, very general factor of Gaussian variables. You can show even for multilinear forms because it's called the hypercontractivity of the variables. But in this, for just the random Fourier series, maybe the easiest is just to show the third thing directly. This implies all the others. And you see that, in fact, this is an infinity norm in the X variable. And so you see that the tail of this object is sub-Gaussian. And using this, it's quite easy to see that, okay, at the end, the last point is the more important for us, that the random Fourier series is gamma s almost surely in cs prime, which is all the space, for all s prime smaller than s minus 1/2. So you lose this 1/2 minus epsilon, we are in dimension one, but you gain all the integrability that you want. This is the kind of the most important information, that you gain integrability indefinitely. But you don't gain regularity, also this Nicola explained it. So the HS minus 1/2 norm is infinite gamma S almost true. Or if you want the measure of this of the space HS minus 1/2, gamma S of the space is zero, which is okay. So essentially this measure C is function at this level of regularity, smaller than S minus 1/2. And also the function that this is are much more integrable than just sobole integrable. Using this, you can show construct the Gibbs measure in support of, you can construct the Gibbs measure. So let me go. So our gamma beta over 2 measure is supported. C is function which are beta over 2 minus 1/2 minus epsilon order. In this space, I said, okay, we want to take very, very, very small dispersion. But even if beta is strictly bigger than 1, beta over 2 minus 1/2 is bigger than 0. So we have always a bit of space. And we said that it's easy to see that the problem is locally posed in C beta prime for any beta prime. So locally we are okay with we have a flow which is locally well defined in the support of the measure. Then the problem is the globalization because the C beta regularity, as I said, is not propagated by the equation. But what you can prove, and this is an important idea again, is that you can propagate it for gamma beta over 2 almost in initial data. So in the support of the measure, not for any initial data, at least you don't know, but with probability 1, okay. And then this is enough to build a global flow for with probability 1. So. And then once you have done this, you may believe that also you show that the measure is in fact invariant that flow. Okay, this is already interesting because you construct a global solution at a low level of regularity, which is interesting. When it's deterministically not clear that you can do it. But the most interesting thing is also that you give information about the long time behavior. Because once you have, this is just abstract result. If you have a dynamical system with an invariant measure, probability measure, Then you have Poincaré recurrence. So you will come back to your initial data infinitely, well, as many clothes as you want for some sequence of times in the future. So it's kind of periodicity. Well, it's a very weak notion of periodicity of solutions. And this is true gamma, beta over two almost for almost the initial data. In the topology, well, in each topology which is compatible with the analysis with support of the measure. So, okay, so this is a nice confidence, completely standard, as I said. A less standard thing is what happens in the dispersionless case. Because in that case, not even the local one, in that case, then the measure is supported on below L2, not even anymore on functions. This is harder, and we still don't know how to do it. It's not impossible that you can do something because there are many examples in which you may construct, which you can also develop a local theory, which is probabilistic. So this is even more less deterministic. I mean, here, at least the local theory is easy and deterministic, then the global theory becomes probabilistic, but there are also cases in which everything is probabilistic. I won't say anything about it. Just the idea of how you show that the regularity is propagated by the existence of an invariant measure is well, a couple of slides. You have to do something in finite dimension to have something meaningful. With a case smaller than this guy, in such a way that we have local weight poisons in CS. We look at the Galerkin approximation of the equation, and it's okay. You may believe that it's, well, of course, no, it's exactly the same. You can develop exactly the same estimate in CS, same local theory. And the point is that it is sufficient to show that the CS regularity is propagated gamma beta over two almost surely for all the for the solution of Galerkin for the approximated solutions for the finite dimensional solution uniformly over n for all the n uniformly over the size of the approximation n. So the obvious thing here is the uniform the non-obvious sorry thing here is the uniformity over n of the bound. Because then these objects are finite dimensional. This you can show for any individual M is obvious that you have this, but it's not clear that you can prove for all the M. Well, okay, once this is true, is okay, you may believe that by some kind of stability result, you can also show that the CS norm is propagated for the actual solution. Maybe you lose epsilon here. This is not so important. So that's how you show how you show this. Well, which one is the idea of the proof of this using the invariance of the measure? So at the end, you have to do something which is still a finite computation. So you take two parameters, which are natural numbers. You have to think about this guy to be very large. Capital T will be the time at which you propagate the regularity. And capital K will be the size of the solution in CS. I do the computation with K and T finite, and then you may believe that you may send to infinity if you have good estimates at the end. PTN is the approximated flow. So this guy now it exists globally, there is no problem. This is well-defined completely object. Using the fact that you have local theory in CS, in fact, what you need to control is the CS norm of this guy, not for any time in zero T, but it's sufficient that you have a grid of times at which this is okay. And the separation in this grid is one over K, which is the K is the size of the CS norm of the solution. And this one over K is essentially the time at which you can propagate the CS norm in the local existence theory. Okay. In general, it's not important, it's minus one. It's just some polynomial thing usually. In this case, it's even minus one. Okay, so what you have to do essentially is just that you have to individuate the bad set of initial data, which are the initial data such that if you make it evolve at some time t, which is in this set, their CS norm will be bigger than k. This is the bad set. And we call it E because E is, stands for exceptional, so we remember that. And this we want to say that is exceptional, that this happens with low probability. You measure the probability, well, it's the sum of these guys and you and bound. You need now to measure this. And here you use that the gamma beta to measure is conserved. So in this identity, you use the invariance of the measure. And this is the most important identity of the group. In fact, you see that you use the invariance of the measure on the finite dimensional solution, which is where it really makes sense, the computation. So you have this. And then we have said before that the tail of the CS norm is sub-exponential if you are at level of regularity S, which is compatible with this. So with S smaller than beta over 2 minus 1/2, which is where we are. And so you need to bound, you have this. And of course you just count these guys are TK in terms in the sum. You have this guy. And so now, okay. If you fix T even very large, then if you take K much larger, this guy is as small as you want. So it's quite believable that then you can even promote this to a statement, which, well, it's quite believable that at the end of these sets are really exceptional in some limit, well, taking the limit as K, which goes to infinity. This is the limit that you take at the end. Okay, so this was a bit the idea, and this is a thing that we're going to need for NLS. In fact, for BBM, it's even more simple because the equation is more simple. And so in the second part of the talk, we still have 25 minutes, I guess. We do something a bit more modern, which is a weaker notion. So the notion of quasi-invariant measure for PD, which is the one that also Nicola introduced. We do first for BBM on the torus. So the notion I recall it, we say that a measure is quasi invariant if, okay, it's not preserved by a flow, but if at least zero measure sets, they are mapped in zero measure sets. This is really the first thing. I mean, if you don't have this, it's really not giving any information to you, this method. So this is a minimal assumption. And it makes sense, make quite sense to consider the evolution of Gaussian measures and to see if this condition is satisfied. Well, as Nicola explained, this is more thing of statistical mechanics. In fact, for instance, the Gibbs measure you may interpret as a weighted Gaussian statistics, which is preserved. Exactly. In general, maybe you think about another Gaussian statistic, if it's destroyed or not. That's the idea. Well, okay, this is very vague. Well, okay, then, okay, maybe I should have just said that this is an interesting mathematical problem, maybe without giving too many interpretations. So this gamma S is the Gaussian measure. We may have a bit of freedom to introduce some corrections, and here the natural correction is that we put the cutoff on the energy, which is conserved, and we say that this has to be smaller than some capital R, which is fixed. And this will be useful to, we cannot prove so much without this. And this is not so much problematic because this is invariant under the flow. So this is a safe quantity to introduce. For BBM, Nicolai proved that if you have very low dispersion, bigger than 4/3, the rho S measure is quasi invariant for the flow. S has to be a bit large in all this statement. Well, in all this statement that I mean, there is always some condition of S, but for instance, for S large, these things are all true. And S large is somehow the most interesting thing if you want to study this problem, because it's the thing that you expect to behave more widely. The things at higher level when you measure higher regularity. So Nicolai proved that this is quasi invariant, and in fact a bit more is true that in fact the density of the transported measure is in LQ for any Q except infinity. Quasi invariant means that this density is in L1 by the Radon-Minkowski theorem. So here you gain a lot of integrability. The limitation is this 4/3. Maybe you would like to take it smaller. You can, and well, we did it in fact considering not this rho s, but rho tilde s, where there is also another correction, which is exponential, with respect to a norm, which is s minus beta over 2, so is in the support of the Gaussian measure, but is not preserved by the evolution. So this guy that you put here is not invariant. So it's, well, it's not clear. Well, of course, this may help you in to do some computation because it makes your measure more or less smaller. But then you have also to look at the time derivative of this guy and you need to look for some compensation. And we prove that putting these with their, well, bigger than two in this case, but in general, you may need to take care very large if you want here to regularize your things. We can reach beta almost one. And we can show, okay, so this is quasi-invariant. This also implies the quasi-invariance for rest because the weight that we put is strictly positive. Okay, it's not super obvious that this implies, but since the weight is positive, you can prove that you also have the quasi-invariance for rest. And for rho tilde, you have also this stronger thing that you are in LQ. Well, the density of the transported measure is, is more integrable as much as you want at any time. And also you even have that, that the density of the transported measure is explicit. You can prove the identity. As Nicolai explained, you always have a formal density. In this case, it was called capital E. In this case, the capital, well, in this case, you had the formula with capital E and the flow. In this case, the capital E is the HS norm. And then there is another norm, HS minus beta over two, which comes from the other correction. Well, okay, in any case, this is the format Nicolai in this specific case. And this formula, not always you can show that is that this is really the density. In this case, we can even show it. And okay, and also the nice thing is that this exponential weight is a bit flexible. You cannot use only for this equation, but you may think about using for other models. For instance, we can say something about NLS using the method of Nicolai, Nicola, and Planchon. And adding this weight, we have some extra property for different measures. In that case, it's even more interesting because okay, you see that this parameter has to be depends on S. It's a bit even less than this R, which is the power of the correction, the exponential correction, the strength of it, the strength of the exponential correction. Okay, this is okay. This is more a tool. I'm not saying that it's useful to simplify things, so to prove something that maybe directly is harder. You can also do things directly. In fact, in this case, for the quasi-invariance, we can even do prove this. The quasi-invariance of the measure with the direct argument, even without the exponential correction, even for beta equals one, but it's much more complicated. And we can prove less. So we just have quasi-invariance. We have that this LQ property, but just for Q strictly bigger than one, for any time, but which goes to one as T goes to infinity. So it's much weaker statement. And this thing we don't have any opportunity. Okay, so okay, the moral here was to introduce this tool of the exponential weight that may be useful in this kind of problems. I think I have still almost 20 minutes. Then I have a bit of slides on the proof, but maybe I will skip it because I think it's a bit more technical. Maybe I prefer just to go to the third part, which is the gauge map associated to the NLS. Because it will be a bit long. At least the goal is to convince you that this gauge map is interesting. For me, it's not clear that it is. But for sure, first we should speak about a bit of the NLS, which is clearly interesting. We are still on. And now this is a Schrödinger model. So U is a complex value. So you have Schrödinger equation, cubic nonlinearity with the derivative, which is much harder, as Michaela clearly explained in her talk. Well, here I would just plus and minus, just to remember that in this case, there is no focusing or defocusing scenario. This makes so much sense. The equation is L2 critical. And the interesting thing, okay, it's very wild because this derivative, but the interesting thing is that it has infinitely many, it's integral, it has infinitely many conservation law. For any integer k, they are some energies, say k, which have a principal part, which is as usual a squared hk naught, plus a correction, which here I'm just writing lower order. then it's quite complicated, the correction, and it's quite important because not all the terms of this guy are the same. There is at least one term which is not, well, yeah, not so much. Of course, it's lower order compared to this, it's clear, but it's a bit unfair to call it lower order because we are not really able to analyze it, even if it has one less derivative in this game. How they look like, these conservative quantities, the first, they are not so hard. There is mass, well, there's L2 squared node, and I said this is critical at this level. There is the energy, which is this. And you see that it doesn't make so much speaking about focusing the focusing because this guy, you have no hope to give him a sign. And this is the problematic guy. This, you have no hope to give a sign. And then the other guys are more complicated, much more complicated. I'm not writing any. We should say that there are also, for instance, there is also a quantity which is analogous to the moment. Well, there is also momentum which is conserved. And in fact, for any k which is okay, here k is integer in this set, in this list. For same integers k, there are also conserved quantity, but the problem is that the main part is not squared sublet norm. It also doesn't have sign. It's not positive or negative. So you cannot really use to do anything, essentially. So we don't really consider. Why these things are used are interesting. Well, a bit implicitly, independent as mathematical object, a bit because they help you to control the sublet norm of the solution. In fact, if the mass is small, which is, remember, called L2 critical problem, and if you have small L2 norm, then you show that the HK norm is conserved by the relative conserved quantity. This is just not hard, it's just use the Gallardo-Nirenberg inequality and structure of the loop. And this is already quite an interesting information, but as you will see, in fact, maybe you can say much more. Okay, so I want to just recall a bit of results that are known on the torus and also on the real line. And of course, this list is very, very partial because there are many results, and I'm just stating the one which are useful for the rest of the talk. On the torus, also on R, you can show that you have local closeness in HS for S bigger or equal than 1/2. And this is minimal in the sense that you can, in the scale of sublet spaces, you cannot go below. You can go below if you change, you don't look at sublet spaces. You can find other spaces which you may say that they have S derivative in some sense. Even, well, there are many results which complement this, but for us, this is the one interesting for this story. So, if this is true, and if the mass is small, you also have global closeness for S bigger or equal than one, because we said that the H1 norm is controlled then by the energy for small masses. And also, you can show that all this AK quantity, with all this AK quantity, you can construct invariant measures associated to this quantity, which are weighted Gaussian measures exactly in the sense that Nicola explained in the story. And they are interesting because, as I said, it gives also information about long time behavior of solutions. For the energy, this is a series of papers. Very interesting. And we did it for just. Generation and Valeri for higher order energy. And these results, these Gibbs, these invariant measure results, they were also small mass. On R, recently, surprisingly, many things happened. And essentially, people in the well-posedness theory, essentially, people they've been able to remove this small mass assumption completely. And this was a really big thing, I think. There is a series of papers. Several authors, and okay, here probably I'm skipping some contribution, where they are able, essentially, in the union of this paper, you can show that your global closeness in H2 plus some other assumptions which are about the decay at infinity of the solution in space variables. And you have no small mass. So, okay, these things are a bit regular, they decay a bit, but still it's really strong. Well, these are really strong. And then Now, recently, people on R, all these things on R, recently, Bauri Perelman, they even removed the, all the extra assumptions. So they just have HS for S bigger or equal than 1/2. And 1/2 regularity is propagated. There is also a paper of Hilbert to Visan and the photo that I remember, which is also important in the year. But the final proof of the propagation is Bauri Perelman. And the other thing is to show the impact that the 1/2 norm is propagated, but then it's not so hard to see that, well, then also the high irregularity are propagated, but it's not so so easy using the conserved quantity. The real, I don't know, is it breakthrough, you say people in this case, and it's an important thing in mathematics, well, in general. It's a 1/2, but 1/2 is propagated, this was hard. And so now you may think that that maybe the same thing can be proved for in the periodic case. There is not a reason to believe that in the periodic case, this thing should be false. But it's still open, I mean, it's still not proved, but now you can believe that it's true. And you can also believe that maybe you can build, in this case, Gibbs measures associated to this invariant, to the conservation law without this assumption. Which, okay, of course, I'm not saying that you can do it easily, but now it looks less undoable than before the series of people. And so this is a bit, okay, this is an interesting problem. And well, there is a tool to study this thing, which is a transformation, which is a gauge transformation, which is very well suited for this problem. And it's an exponential multiplication against the phase. U is the solution of the MLS we have to think about. And there is an exponential here, and this I here is essentially the zero average primitive of the square of the argument minus the correction, which is the L2 norm of the argument. The L2, this correction is independent on alpha, you see, because this map preserves the L2 norm here. If you want, the I is this explicit, if you want an explicit formula. And I think the best way to look at this map, rather than this direct formulation, is as a solution of D, which is evolution in alpha. So alpha is a parameter here. So this is not just one map, it's a family of maps with some parameter. Alpha is a real number. You have this OD, which is kind of cubic OD, because this guy here is quadratic, but it has some regularization because there is an integral. It has some smooth here. But you have on the other end no dispersion. So it's not so obvious. It's not so hard to study this OD, but not incredibly obvious. And why this thing, this map, this equation are interesting? Essentially, because you can use it to simplify the DNLS equation in two ways. First, you look how the equation changes under the gauge transformation. So B is the new solution, and it solves this equation, which is basically the DNLS. But the nonlinearity has been split into parts. So if alpha is equal to zero, of course, this map is the identity. You recover exactly the NLS. And in fact, if you sum two times this plus this, you have the NLS nonlinearity. But this decoupling is important because essentially one part of the nonlinearity is harder than the other to analyze for the local Galois equations. The first part is the harder. Than the second, because there are more resonances. Well, this I will not explain. But it's an important thing of the local Poisson's theory. Then there are other terms, but they have no derivatives. So at least for the local Poisson's, we are not so afraid. Then they are important because, for instance, here there is a quintic term. So for the global Poisson's, of course, this may be important. Well, this is important, but for the local Poisson's, we don't care so much. And so the moral is that if you choose alpha equal to minus one in this transformation map, you simplify a lot the equation by the point of view of the dynamic, the local dynamic at least. And then there is another thing that you can do. If you put alpha, okay, before saying this, then you may also look at how the conservation law changes under this map. You have a new conserved quantity, which are very similar to the old one. They still have a principal part, which is a squared Sobolev norm, plus some lower order terms, which are similar to the other, more, well, depends on alpha, of course, but they have similar algebraic structure. And there is, for any k, there is one choice of alpha, which simplifies the most problematic of the lower order terms. So essentially, there is, for any k, there is one alpha which simplifies these lower order terms quite a lot. And the it's interesting to note that for k equal to one is not the same alpha. Because here it's minus 3/4. So if you want to simplify the energy, you don't simplify the dynamic. If you want to simplify dynamics, you don't simplify the energy. So the, well, this map is kind of, if you make alpha, okay, for some values of alpha, it's kind of interesting. So these are the two philosophies. Either you simplify dynamics, either you simplify the conservation. And so this is just okay to motivate a bit why it's interesting to study this map. And of course, in all the results about Gibbs measure, this map has been used. You cannot prove it without this for now. Maybe there is a way for sure, but it's hard. And of course, to prove this result, you have also to use the fact that at least this map doesn't send sets of zero measure into sets of zero measure. Otherwise, you cannot say anything about the original equation because you lose all the information. So it's useful. So this was just to motivate why it's useful to study the evolution of Gaussian measures with respect to this gauge map. So this was the goal of this introduction. So we take Gaussian measures, we put cutoff on the L2 norm, which is conserved quantity, conserved by the gauge, so completely harmless. And here we have a parameter that if you want to build to study Gibbs measure for the NLS with small mass, you can take this R very small. But if you want to treat the large mass case, it's interesting also to take this R very large. And at least we proved recently that this map, even for R very large and even for very irregular Gaussian measures, because here we are with S bigger than one half, and this is a limit threshold because below with S equal to one half, you don't even have functions. So you are not in L2, it's not three, but this is really optimal. Then we have that the measure is quasi invariant at least. Slightly more in the sense that the density of the transported measure is an LQ again for some Q bigger than one for any alpha, but this Q goes to one when alpha goes to infinity and also when R goes to infinity. But at least the quasi invariance is true for any alpha, for any R, even R very large. And this was the thing we were a bit more interested in. Well, at least we discovered during the proof that this was the most interesting thing. Well, in fact, there is not really a reason for which for the gauge map, you should take R small. For the DNLS, of course, there is a serious reason. Then, okay, recently people have been also able to remove it, but for the gauge map, there is not really a reason, except that the only result which was known before, which was a really beautiful proof, worked for S equal to one, because they were interested to the energy case, which is probably the most important case. And it worked with R very small. And the proof they really use this. It's a bit weird, but they really do it. And their proof compared to our proof, okay, this is as this minus, which I think is important, but it's also surprising plus that they are even able to represent the evolution, the density here, and we are not. Well, of course, we have it formally, but we're not able to show. To prove that this is, and they are able to prove them. Well, the arguments are very different. This is really direct and long. Their argument is really few pages, it's really, but looks a bit special, a bit adapted to the case S equal to one, that's this limitation. Okay, and I thank you very much for the attention, and it's all.
So thank you for your nice and interesting talk.
Good.
And as before, let us first ask the colleagues from internet if they have some observation, remarks. It is sufficient to switch on microphone and speak.
Remember to switch on the mic.
Yes.
Okay, then we can turn to the audience. Shall we meet microphone or we shall speak?
I think you can hear at the end, no? I speak loud. No?
Ah, non viceversa. Allora chi... okay, okay. If we understand, we shall repeat.
Ah, okay. Try, otherwise I bring the microphone.
Actually, may I have one small question? For when you write GDNS, there is also generalized derivative NLS, which is different for the non-linearity, it's a little bit different, which is not mass critical. Is it possible to generalize the result because it is considered for global existence even easier?
Okay. How is it for non-linearity? I don't know the question.
Under DX, instead of U modulus of U to the power 2, you have modulus of U to some power P, which is generalized derivative NLS. If there is some possibility to.
This is new. I don't know if it's integrable. But the energy, of course, you may try with the energy. I think there is the energy for sure. And this,
yes, there are quantities that.
There are even quantities. Probably, yes.
And if we compare with global existence,
it's even easier.
Global existence exists before global existence.
Okay. For the, also in periodic.
I'm not sure. I'm speaking about RM. I don't know.
You're speaking about RM. So it's not on the real line of generalization. It's more dimensional.
No, it is one dimension. Always derivative NLS is one dimension.
Okay, and there is global closeness on R.
Yes, which is easier. It's bigger than two.
So probably, yes. Yeah, I would say that. Yeah, I will maybe study this way. I didn't mean about this equation. Yeah, that's nice. Thank you.
Okay, probably some other questions, please.
Sure.
There's more questions. Yeah. I get lost on one point. If you have two conserved quantities of the system, and you know that. Is to commute. Which is the relation between the measure that you obtain in the exponential?
They are. I can repeat. If you take
what two, is the question?
Yeah, sure. He's asking if you have two conserved quantity of these. For instance, E1 and A2. A1 and for just to be concrete, they are linearly independent. They are all linear. Okay, I didn't say that, but these are all linearly independent. This quantity. When is the relation between the measure that you are? They are mutually singular. Singular. Right, essentially, there's no relation. This is the answer. There's no relation. That's also, there's no relation.
That's a pulse.
Yeah, this I meant with disjoint. Then all the time I'm saying support for this measure, this is a bit toward the. Do you know if,
but then, so if you can prove that,
take the microphone.
Internet non capiscono.
Portiamo il microfono.
Ok, proviamo. We invite the questioner to come here, please.
So. Then, if you know, if you prove that,
could you speak up?
If you prove that are invariant, then what you can say about the dynamics of the PD? I mean, you see that as a corollary, no, you can prove some like recurrence theorem, no. So if they are all which mutually singular, maybe you can say something on the dynamics. I mean,
you can, of course, and it's a good point. And what you can say is that you have this recurrence theorem, and as I said, the topology of this theorem depends on the, it has to be compatible with the measure. So if you are the measure k, you can say that here you can put h s for s smaller than k minus one half minus x. So when k is large, in fact, it's quite interesting because the topology is strong. So you get very more precise information about the coefficients. Then, of course, it's not so clear which one at the zero measure set. This is a bit more delicate.
Because I was thinking maybe you can say that you can say something, no? Almost for almost any initial data for some measure. Then, if you can say the same for other measure, then maybe you can cover the sets that you don't cover with.
Well, this you somehow you do because the supports are
distributed.
Yeah. But then you cannot really say, well, what's the union of this thing? These things are not clear.
Okay.
Well, you don't have so many information. Well, in fact, the zero measure set, one of the limitations of this method is that I think the zero measure sets are not so, well, for me, are not so well identified. But maybe Nicola was much better with that because he worked also on it. Because they developed a theory which was very beautiful. Well, this was the reason for which I started to study this equation with DNS, because they did the same thing for Benjamin Ohm. Okay. And they had all these recurrence in HS with S very large, which was very strong result. But now you can even do it deterministically, but once they did, it was very hard to do what? It was very pioneering by this point. And for instance, for DNLS probably is the same, and maybe these results, maybe this recurrence, it's even true for all the initial data. It's even true deterministically. So, but this is just a thing which is easier to be proved because it's weaker.
Say because there are weak of coordinates.
Maybe there are not, in this case, it's not known, but.
No, but in the Benjamin.
Benjamin equation, there are now Gerard and Kaffler, they build the weak of coordinates.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you very much. And if there are no more questions, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you very much.